Gilman's. Eric.
Eric.
And Billy Butler. Billy Butler. And Todd is here. Jordan King. Rachel Kerr is here. Hope. Hope. Nathan Coler here. Ryan Baker. Dara Lee. And Gloria Madero. Gloria. Hannah McGee. Frank. Riley. Riley.
Right here.
Oh, sorry. Priscilla Tinkero. Priscilla. And Maria Reeves. Maria. Matthew Reeves.
Here.
Crystal Rowe. Alejandro Salazar. Alejandro Salinas. Samantha Torres.
Yeah.
Kaylee. Volker. Kaylee. Faith.
Here.
Okay. Melissa Walter.
Here.
And Luis O'Neil. Bet I didn't get it. Kristen. Carolyn, that's right. Okay. Welcome to another exciting lecture in the US government. Hold on tight, okay? Let me close the door. Okay, so the discussion today is on public opinion. Just some highlights from the chapter. It's actually a pretty interesting chapter. It's not as bad as it might seem. A lot of graphs and numbers out there. But it makes sense to a certain degree. Okay, public opinion. The definition of public opinion, of course, attitudes of citizens concerning a given issue or question. We're familiar to polls. We always see them on TV and the newspaper polls, how people feel about a particular issue, or polling actually got invented by business groups to sell products. But in politics and government, the measuring of public opinion, what people are thinking, is important for government, for policymakers. Okay? So, public opinion then, the public's attitude towards a given issue can vary over time, often dramatically. We do a poll, we try to measure how do people feel about this or that, political party, a particular issue, and some issues, and some attitudes remain pretty constant, others change dramatically. And a lot of the graphs and the data that is interpreted here comes from the National Election Studies. It comes out of the University of Michigan. That's the one we use in graduate school. You get all the data. They do a poll every year, and they've been doing it for 50-something years. And this is what political scientists use for all this data that's here. They do it for 50 years, and they survey the general population on a variety of different issues. Political party, social issues, economic issues, all the issues you can think about. I think they put out, the data, and then we're the ones who know what's in graduate school that do all these little graphs and stuff, try to make sense of it, what it means. So that's really where it comes from. So on some particular issues, some change, some don't. attitudes of communication can vary over time, often dramatically. The example that's given here, for example, the issue of gay marriage, clearly that has changed from 20, 30 years ago. That's an example. Through time, people's attitudes have changed dramatically. When you look at numbers, that is, you get about a particular issue. Others remain pretty much constant. You know. People feel the same way about the public part or the budget or issues that are pretty much constant. And some, it varies, some they remain pretty much the same. But for government, public opinion establishes boundaries on allowable types of public policy. So one of the values for those that make policy is that public opinion establishes like parameters. You're a policymaker, then you look at attitudes of people, how they feel about a particular issue, and it serves as boundaries. I mean, you don't want to go too much this way or too much this way. Public opinion helps, okay, in establishing those boundaries. That's what that means. Public opinion places boundaries. That's valuable for policymakers. Another thing about pollsters. You've asked by pollsters, citizens are willing to register their opinions on matters outside their expertise. Because how do we measure public opinion? Through polls, right? Polling. Okay. The Gallup poll, television does poll, newspapers do poll. There's all kinds of organizations and groups that do polls. And they do polls by telephone. Telephone has become the means of polling. I don't know if you ever got a phone call or not, about a survey, you know. Sometimes you get called. Sometimes you don't get called about a survey. We ask for 5 minutes of your time. We've got some important questions to ask about a poll. You know? So, if asked by pollsters, citizens are willing to register opinions on matters outside their expertise. People are always willing to give an opinion. They might not necessarily be as informed about a specific issue that they're asking about. But people are always willing to give an opinion. That's what they're doing. And government tends to respond to public opinion. In most cases, public opinion and government policy many times has a correlation. So. But the government sometimes does not do what Dumbo wanted to do. You know, sometimes government does things that public opinion reflects otherwise. So it goes both ways. So some points about public opinion is it affects government here. Okay, so assumptions about the role of public opinion in a government. This is ours, democratic government. Okay, we know what public opinion is. Polls have been taken, we do the polling. You know, trying to get a feel how people feel about this and that, which relates to government or policy or whatever. And so, if we try to fit that in to our government structure and our democratic form of government, the two models we talked about, majoritarian and pluralist model. Okay, in the majoritarian model, if we do a poll and people feel a certain way, then, according to this model, government should do what that majority reflects. I mean, that should be a strong correlation. That's basically what he's saying. And government, according to this majoritarian model, people have a clear, consistent opinions on government policies, so government should do what a majority of the public wants. Remember, the majoritarian model is about people, and the big assumption here is that people are informed about government in the model, that is, theoretically, should be informed. So therefore, whatever opinions are reflected here should be what government should be doing. There should be a strong relationship there. But that's the big assumption there. People are informed. And therefore, they opinion in a poll, so there should be a strong correlation. Government should be doing what that majority of opinion reflects. Okay? And generally, we like that. I mean, talk about democracy. We want government to do what the people want it to do. What do the people want? Well, measure it through a poll. You know, no other way of measuring. But 340 million people in America feel, you know, we do it through a poll. So that's a majoritarian view. And that, of course, runs counter to the other model, the pluralist model. Remember, one of the assumptions here about the pluralist model is that people really are not as informed. Therefore, what is the validity of a public of an opinion poll then? If opinions were given and people were not as informed, therefore, pluralists are saying government then should do more about what groups want. That should be the reflection of public policy. So that's basically what he's saying. It assumes that people are not as informed and ambivalent about specific issues, and so government should rely more on groups. So public opinion then, you define what public opinion is. Those attitudes that people have, they're measured through a poll, and then how they would fit into one or the other model. Majoritarians would want opinion to reflect what government does. And the pluralist model is saying, well, public opinion does inform. So it's about groups. That's what policy should reflect. So pretty simple, okay? Thank you.